Hello guys, welcome to the new video. In today's video, we are going to study about the diaphragm, or you can say thoracoabdominal diaphragm. This is a diaphragm which separates thoracic cavity from abdominal cavity. So let's start this topic. Before starting the topic, please make sure that you have subscribed to my channel and also press the notification bell button so you will not miss any update about a new video from our channel. So the diaphragm or thoracoabdominal diaphragm. So this type of diaphragm, this shaped diaphragm present between our thorax and abdominal cavity. Diaphragm is a large dome shaped flat muscle which closes the thoracic outlet. So diaphragm is a dome shaped flat muscle which closes the thoracic outlet, and it have two domes, right dome and left dome. So if you see this diagram, this is a central tendon part, and to the right it is a right dome of diaphragm, and to the left it is a left dome of diaphragm. Diaphragm have two parts. One is peripheral, which is a muscular part, and one is central part, which is a fibrous part, that is called as central tendon. So diaphragm have two parts, peripheral and central. As you can see in this diagram, the brownish part, which is present on the periphery, is this muscular part. It is made up of muscles. And the part of diaphragm which is present in the center, as you can see, this is green part, that is a fibrous part. It is made of fibers, that is known as central tendon part. Now let's discuss about the how the origin of diaphragm takes place. Diaphragm originate from three different parts. That is why it have three different origins. That is sternal part, some fibers arise from sternum, costal part, some fibers arise from ribs, and vertebral part, some fibers arise from vertebras. External part, two fleshy slips arise from posterior surface of Ziffert process. So from the posterior part of Ziffert process, two slips of diaphragm arise as a sternal part. In this diaphragm, this is a Zeffy sternum or Ziffert process. From here, two slips will arise like this, and it will converge toward the central tendon. So this part of diaphragm will be a sternal part because it have origin from the sternum, that is from Ziffert process. Second is the costal part, that is six fleshy slips on each side arise from inner surface of lower six rib, that is 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th ribs. From the inner surface of these 7 or 6 ribs, some fleshy slips will take origin as a diaphragm, and these parts are known as costal part of diaphragm. In this diaphragm, this is 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th and 12th. These are 6 ribs. And you can see on each side some fleshy fibers arise from these ribs. As you can see, these are costal origin of the diaphragm. And same origin of fibers takes place on right side or as well as on left side. So these are the costal origin of the diaphragm. Third one is vertebral part. Some fibers takes origin from the vertebras as right and left truss of diaphragm, and there are also five arcuate ligaments. So fibers which arise from vertebra have given some specific names, that is right and left truss of diaphragm and some arcuate ligaments. And the five arcuate ligaments are, one is median arcuate ligament, two are medial arcuate ligament, and two are lateral arcuate ligaments. Total five arcuate ligaments. Two will be medial, two will be lateral, and one will be median arcuate ligament. So after the costal origin of diaphragm, some fibers, as you can see in this diagram, takes place origin like from posterior side, so that is from vertebra. These are called as vertebral origin of the diaphragm. So below 12th rib and posterior to that, all fibers are of vertebral origin of diaphragm. What is the right cross of diaphragm? Right cross of diaphragm arises from right side of L1, L2, L3 lumbar vertebrae and intervening in the vertebral discs. So, from the anterior aspect of right side of L1, L2, L3 vertebra, lumbar vertebra, some fibers arise and also between also from intervening intervertebral disc, like that is disc between L1, L2 vertebrae, L2, L3 vertebrae. From there also fibers arise and these fibers are known as right cross of diaphragm. In this diagram, you can see this is L1 vertebra, this is L2, this is L3, and this is the disc between L1, L2, and this is the disc between L2, L3. So from the anterior aspect of the right side of the L1, L2, L3 vertebra, and from the intervertebral disc, some fibers arise, like you can see this muscular part brownish. This is known as right cross of diaphragm. Similarly, left cross arises from L1, L2 lumbar vertebrae, but it is from left side, not from right side, and their intervening intervertebral disc. So, from the left side of L1, L2 vertebrae and intervening disc between L1 and L2 vertebrae, from the left side, these muscular fibers are arising. That is, muscular part, this is known as left cross of diaphragm. The difference here is right cross arises from L1, L2, L3 vertebrae, but the left cross derive only from L1 and L2 vertebrae. Now, what is median arcuate ligament? It is a ligament which is present between the upper ends of right and left cross. So, from the upper end of right cross and left cross, there is a ligament which is joining these two crosses. These are known as median arcuate ligament. And you can see this greenish structure which is connecting both the ligament which is connecting both the crust, this is known as median arcuate ligament. This is the median arcuate ligament. What is medial arcuate ligament? It is a ligament which is extending from the side of the body of L2 vertebrae to the tip of transverse process of L1 vertebra. So, it extends from L2 vertebrae body and between a tip of transverse process of L1 vertebra. As you can see in this diagram, from the side of the body of L2 vertebrae, this greenish ligament is arising and then it is inserting into the transverse process of L1 vertebra above. That is, it is arising from the body of L2 vertebra and it is inserting into the transverse process of L1 vertebra above. This is greenish structure is known as medial arcuate ligament. What is lateral arcuate ligament? It extends from the tip of transverse process of L1 vertebrae to the 12th rib. That is, it extends between transverse process of L1 vertebrae and 12th rib. As you can see in this diagram, from the transverse process of L1 vertebrae, one ligament, greenish ligament, is arising and then it is inserting to the lower surface of 12th rib. This is known as lateral arcuate ligament. As you can see here, this is lateral arcuate ligament. So, medial arcuate ligament extends from L2 vertebrae to tip of transverse process of L1 vertebrae, and from tip of transverse process of L1 vertebrae, another ligament is arising to 12th rib. This is known as lateral arcuate ligament, and this one is known as medial arcuate ligament. Now, insertion. Where are the muscular fibers which are arising from sternal, costal and vertebral part, where they are inserting? That is why I am going to study, that is insertion. These are inserted into the central part called central tendon. So these all fibers are inserting into the margins of the central tendon. As you can see in this diagram, all the brownish fibers arising from sternal part, costal part, vertebral part, and then they are converging towards the central part, and these fibers are inserting into the margins of central tendon. This is the central tendon, and in the margin of central tendon all the fibers are inserting. So this is all about the origin, like from where muscular fibers are arising and where the muscular fibers are inserting in the central tendon. So this is the origin and insertion of the diaphragm. Now next we are going to study about the openings of the diaphragm. There are several openings in the diaphragm, some major openings which are big and some minor openings which are small. But important thing you have to know here is about the major openings. And so many questions are asked in university exam and also in PG exams from these major openings, that is, what is the vertebral level of these major openings and what are the structures passing through these major openings. So you have to remember all this, it is so important for you. So first opening is vena cava opening, and this is known as vena cava opening because from here inferior vena cava passes. This opening is present in the central tendon. As you can see in the central tendon, you are seeing this opening and the inferior vena cava here. This is the vena cava opening of the inferior vena cava. And what is the vertebral level where the vena cava opening is found? That is T8 vertebra. At this level, vena cava opening is present. And what are the structures passing through vena cava opening? These structures are itself inferior vena cava passes through it, and also along with that right phrenic nerve also passes. So you have to remember these structures. And what is the effect of contraction of diaphragm? That is, when diaphragm will contract, what will be the effect of that diaphragm on the vena cava opening? That is, vena cava opening will be enlarged or dilated to enhance venous return. So let me explain this thing. So this is a diaphragm. When diaphragm will contract, all these muscles will be pulled towards outside, like towards these origins, and the central tendon part will be pulled from all the sides. So it will contribute. So the opening of inferior vena cava or vena cava opening in turn become big or enlarged or dilated as this will be pushed or pulled from all sides. So this opening will be dilated, and you know when the diaphragm will contract, it will descend in the abdominal cavity. So the pressure in the abdominal cavity will increase and the pressure in the thoracic cavity will decrease. So blood from the abdominal cavity have more pressure, so it will be thrown towards the abdominal cavity. That is, it is pushed towards the abdominal cavity because there is more pressure in the abdominal cavity. So there will be enhanced venous return through this inferior vena cava opening, through vena cava, inferior vena cava in the right atrium of the heart. So this is the effect of contraction of diaphragm on the inferior vena cava opening. Second important or major opening is esophageal opening. From this opening, esophagus passes in the abdomen, and this opening is present in the muscular part of diaphragm at the level of T10 vertebra. In this diagram, the opening which you are seeing in the muscular part, this is the esophageal opening, and it is present at the T10 vertebral level. And what are the structures passing through this opening itself? Esophagus and right and left vagal trunks or vagus nerves and esophageal branches of left gastric artery. So these structures you have to remember: esophagus, right and left vagal nerve and esophageal branches of left gastric artery. In this diagram you can see in the opening, this is the esophagus and this is the esophageal branch of left gastric artery, and these on the sides are left vagal trunk and the right vagal trunk or right or left vagal nerves or vagus nerves. What is the effect of contraction of diaphragm on this esophageal opening? Contraction of diaphragm has sphincteric effect on esophageal opening. That is, when diaphragm contracts, it acts as sphincter on esophageal opening, that is, it will block the esophageal opening. But the question is why the it acts as a sphincter on esophageal opening, but it acts on opposite, like it dilates vena cava opening, but it acts as sphincteric effect on esophageal opening. As you can see in this diagram, the esophageal opening is present in the brownish muscular part, that is, it is present in the muscular part. So when the muscle fibers contract during the contraction of diaphragm, the esophageal opening will be constricted, it will become narrow, and that is why it acts as a sphincter. The contraction of diaphragm acts as an sphincter on the esophageal opening. The vena cava opening is present in the tendon parts, so it dilates, but it is present in the esophageal opening is present in the muscular part, so contraction of muscles will be there, so it will act as a sphincteric or sphincter. That is why it is says that on esophageal opening there will be a functional sphincter but not anatomical sphincter. And the contraction of diaphragm on esophageal opening act as an sphincter, so it have a benefits, so that the acid contents, that is food acid contents from the stomach, will not come up again in the esophagus normally. So it is important to act of diaphragm on esophageal opening as an sphincter. Now the third one is aortic opening or aorta opening, from where the aorta passes in the abdomen. From thorax to the abdomen, aorta will process. Aortic opening is present behind the median arcuate ligament. You can see it is exactly present outside the diaphragm. As you can see in this diagram, this is the median arcuate ligament, greenish part, and behind that, this is the aorta. So it is, the aorta is present behind the median arcuate ligament on the posterior side, that is on anterior aspect of the vertebras. So we cannot say it is exactly present within the diaphragm, it is present outside the diaphragm. And what is the vertebral level of aortic opening is T12 vertebrae. And what are the structures passes through this opening? That is azygous vein, thoracic duct, and the aorta itself passes through its azygous vein, thoracic duct, and aorta. So you have to remember all the structures passing through these openings. And what is the effect of contraction of diaphragm on the aortic opening? There will be no effect on opening, that is, no, the contraction of diaphragm have no effect on the aortic opening. Why? Because the aortic opening is present little bit outside the diaphragm. It is not present exactly in the diaphragm, but it is present like little outside the diaphragm. Therefore, diaphragm contraction have no effect on aortic opening, nor it will dilate the opening, or not it will contract or constrict the opening. Now there are various minor openings also in the diaphragm, but you don't have to know about all the minor openings. You have to just know the like one word, space of Leyre. Space of Leyre is a gap between muscular slips arising from Ziffert process and seventh costal cartilage. So between the Ziffert process and seventh costal cartilage, you will see a gap. Normally there is a gap present here. This is known as space of Leyre. As you can see in this diagram, this is the sternum or Ziffert process, and this is the seventh costal cartilage, and on each side this is the slips arising from Ziffert process, and this is the slips arise from seventh rim. Between these slips there will be a gap on both sides. That gap is present normally, it is not present like a defect, it is present normally in a human being. This gap between the Ziffert process and seventh costal cartilage on both sides, this space is known as space of Leyre, and from there some structures passes from this gap, some structures passes from thorax to the abdomen. And what are these structures which are passing through this opening, the space of Leyre? You have to just know that superior epigastric vessel, superior epigastric artery, which is a branch of internal thoracic artery, and superior epigastric vein. These vessels pass through the space of larynx, which is a minor opening. In this diagram also, here some vessels are showing these are superior epigastric vessels on both sides. Now, the another topic is, what is the nerve supply of the diaphragm? For motor action, for contraction or relaxation of diaphragm, diaphragm is supplied by phrenic nerve. That is, right dome supplied by right phrenic nerve and left dome supplied by left phrenic nerve. And the phrenic nerve root value is C3, C4, C5. And these are the nerves arising from cervical segments. But then why they are supplying the diaphragm, which is present in the abdomen? Because diaphragm was previously in the embryonic life. It is developed in the neck region and then it descends down in the abdomen region, thoraco-abdomen junction. That's why its nerve supply is derived from the cervical segments. So after descending it, after it descend down in the abdomen, its phrenic nerve also come with us downwards. And what is the sensory supply for the diaphragm? The central tendril will be supplied by phrenic nerve. Sensory supply will be phrenic nerve, and the peripheral parts of diaphragm will be supplied by lower intercostal nerves. So simply we can say that this is a diaphragm, and the motor supply of diaphragm is given by right and left phrenic nerve. And for sensory supply, the central part of tendon or central tendon is supplied, sensory supply is given by phrenic nerves, right and left phrenic nerve. And for peripheral parts, sensory supply to the peripheral parts of diaphragm is given by lower intercostal nerves like T7, T8, T11, T12. These intercostal nerves will give sensory supply to the peripheral parts of the diaphragm. Now, what is the arterial supply? Arteries which are supplying the diaphragm: superior phrenic artery, inferior phrenic artery, pericardio phrenic artery, musculophrenic artery, superior epigastric artery, and lower five intercostal and subcostal arteries. Superior phrenic artery, which is a artery from thoracic aorta, branch of thoracic aorta. Inferior phrenic artery, which is a branch of abdominal aorta. Pericardiophrenic, musculophrenic, and superior epigastric artery, these are the branches of internal thoracic artery. That is, it is a just normal branch, and these two are the terminal branches of internal thoracic artery. And these are lower five intercostal and subcostal arteries are the branches of aorta. So these all are supplying the gives arterial supply to the diaphragm. Now, what are the actions of the diaphragm? Diaphragm is the main or principal muscle of respiration. That is, it is an important muscle for respiration. When diaphragm contracts, it descends downs and it increases the vertical diameter of the thoracic cavity. So it will increases the thoracic volume, which will in turn help in inspiration. So diaphragm is an important muscle for inspiration or for respiration also. And when diaphragm will relax, it will decreases the thoracic volume. It will ultimately help in expiration. Diaphragm also helps in expulsive function during the act of vomiting, micturition, defecation, and parturition. When diaphragm contracts, it will descend in abdominal cavity. So intra-abdominal pressure will increase. So ultimately, intra-abdominal pressure will increase. It ultimately facilitates the vomiting, act of vomiting, micturition, defecation, and parturition. What are hiccups, or we can say in Hindi, what is hitchki? When hitchkis come, like we used to say, like someone is missing a spit, but it is not like that. It is like anatomical thing or anatomical phenomena. What is hiccups? Due to involuntary spasmodic contraction of diaphragm while closure of glottis, it is known as hiccups. During irritation of phrenic nerve or during irritation of diaphragm, when diaphragm get irritated, it will be sensed by sensory supply. And when there is involuntary spasmodic contractions of diaphragm and also closure of glottis. You will see hiccups or hitchy. At that time, no one is missing you. You have to just like hiccups is maybe due to the gastric irritation or gastric acid secretion. Uremia are also some pathological conditions in which you can see hiccups. Now, the another important thing for the diaphragm is what are the parts, what are the different parts from where diaphragm is developed in the embryo. So, four names you have to remember here is septum, transversum, pleuroperitoneal membranes, dorsal mesentery of esophagus and body wall. From these four structures, diaphragm develops in an embryo. So you can see in this diaphragm, this is the zygote process and posteriorly this is vertebra. From septum transversum, this is septum transversum, this is pleuroperitoneal membrane, this is body wall and this is dorsal mesentery of esophagus, because esophagus present on posterior side. So from dorsal mesentery of esophagus, diaphragm develops. So these are the four parts from where diaphragm develops. You can say from septum transversum, central tendon of diaphragm develops, and from pleuroperitoneal membrane, right and left dome of diaphragm develops, and from dorsal mesentery of esophagus, vertebral part of diaphragm will develop, and from body wall, peripheral parts of diaphragm will develop. So these are the some names you have to remember: septum transversal, pleuroperitoneal membrane, body wall and dorsal mesentery of esophagus, from which diaphragm develops. Now we will study about diaphragmatic hernias. In diaphragm you saw major openings and some minor openings also, but sometimes these openings when become more enlarged, or when there is a opening which is not present normally in a human being, then there will be hernia. The abdominal contents will come up in the thoracic cavity. This is known as diaphragmatic hernia. So what are the different congenital hernia, that is the what are the diaphragmatic hernias which can present from birth, that is congenital hernias. First one is posterolateral hernia. The name is posterolateral hernia because it is present on the posterior side of the posterior part of the diaphragm and also on the lateral posterolateral part of diaphragm. That is why it is known as posterolateral hernia. And remember, posterolateral hernia is the most common congenital diaphragmatic hernia. Most commonly in congenital conditions you will see the posterolateral hernia. What is posterolateral hernia? There is a gap between costal and vertebral origins of diaphragm. That is from the parts of diaphragm which arise from ribs and from the parts of diaphragm which arise from vertebra. You see the slits from different parts from vertebral origin and costal origins, and in between these origins you will see a gap. From these gap the herniation will occur. That is known as posterolateral hernia, and the gap will known as foramen of Bogdalek, or it is also known as Bogdalek hernia. As you are seeing in this diagram, these are the costal origins of diaphragm, and these are the right crest, left crest and arcuate ligament. These are the vertebral origins of diaphragm. Between costal and vertebral origins of diaphragm, you see here a gap, that is posterolaterally, posterior side, and on the lateral side of diaphragm. This is known as posterolateral hernia. Here it will occur, and the foramen which will develop, the gap will develop, is known as Bogdalek foramen. That's why this hernia is also known as Bogdalek hernia. Why the gap will occur in posterolateral part of diaphragm? Because due to failure of closure of pleuroperitoneal canal. When the pleuroperitoneal canal will not close, normally it will close, but if it will not close and it will fail to close, there will be a gap in posterolateral part of diaphragm, and therefore the foramen will present here, Bogdalek foramen. From there, herniation of stomach contents will occur, or abdominal contents of human body will come in the thoracic cavity. So the herniation will takes place like this. And remember, the gap will present, can be present on both sides, left side and right side, but most commonly द पोस्टेरियर लेटरल हर्निया और बॉगडलेंक हर्निया विल प्रेजेंट ऑन लेफ्ट साइड. इट विल प्रेजेंट ऑन राइट साइड ऑल्सो बट मोस्ट कॉमनली मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम्स इट विल प्रेजेंट ऑन द लेफ्ट साइड. एंड हाउ टू रिमेंबर दिस, द नेम इज पोस्टेरियर लेटरल हर्निया. इन दिस नेम यू विल सी द एल, दैट इज वाई इट इज अकर मोस्ट कॉमनली ऑन द लेफ्ट साइड. सो एल will L. It is will occur on the left side. And another one is retroesternal, and here you will see R. So it will most commonly occur on right side. So L will occur on left side. R, if there is R, it will occur most commonly on the right side. This is the image of the posterior lateral or Bogdalek hernia of diaphragm. You can see on the posterior or lateral part of the diaphragm. Posteriorly, you will see a gap. This is a Bogdalek foramen. Or posterior lateral foramen will be there. From there, the contents of abdomen, like stomach, esophagus, upper part, it will come in the thoracic cavity, and it will push the heart and lungs to on opposite sides. So it will be a herniation of abdominal contents into the thoracic cavity. This is known as posterior lateral hernia. It will occur on the posterior lateral part of the diaphragm. Now the next one is the retroesternal hernia. This is also congenital because it is present from the birth. As you saw, the gap between the external and costal origins of diaphragm, we call that space as space of Leri. When the space of Leri becomes enlarged or so much big, this foramen is known as, or this space is known as space, or this is known as foramen of Morgagni. So from this gap, which there will be a herniation of abdominal contents like stomach, and it will present on the posterior side of sternum. So we use the term retro for posterior. So it will on the posterior side of sternum. So retro sternal in position. And as I told you, it is the first letter will be R. So it will be most common on the right side. So you can see in this diagram, this is the repair process. These are the seventh rib costal cartilage. In between, you see this gap. This is known as space of Leri. When this space of Leri becomes so much enlarged, this space will be called as space of Morgagni. And from this space, stomach, like abdominal contents will come up into the thoracic cavity. That's why it is known as for Morgagni hernia, or also known as retroesternal hernia, because the space is present on the posterior side of the sternum. So this is known as retroesternal hernia or Morgagni hernia. And there are some acquired diaphragmatic hernias, that is hernias which are not commonly present from birth, but these are acquired after later on in the human life due to muscle weakness of diaphragm or some more increased intra-abdominal pressure. Some causes are there. Due to that, there will be acquired diaphragmatic hernias. So hiatal or sliding hernia is an example of acquired hernia, that is it will acquired later in the human life. And hiatal or sliding hernia is commonest of all the internal acquired hernias. All the hernias which are occurred after the birth, that is in the later in human life, the most common internal acquired hernia will be hiatal or sliding hernia. It is the most common acquired hernia. In this hernia, what will happen? Gastroesophageal junction between the esophagus and stomach, and some part of cardiac end of stomach. There are three parts of stomach: cardiac, fundus, and body. Or pyloric end also there. So some part of stomach, that is cardiac end and gastroesophageal junction, slides up from abdominal cavity into the thoracic cavity. So this hernia is known as hiatal or sliding hernia. As you can see in this diagram, this is a diaphragm and this is a junction, that is esophagus, and this is the stomach part. This is a gastroesophageal junction. This is the normal position of stomach, that is it is the cardiac end and junction will be around at the diaphragm, or below the diaphragm will be the cardiac end of stomach. But when there will be a hiatal or sliding hernia, as you can see, diaphragm is there, but the gastroesophageal junction, which was earlier here, and the cardiac end of stomach, which was here. The cardiac end of stomach and gastroesophageal junction from abdominal cavity come up into the thoracic cavity because the gap here in the hiatal or sliding hernia will be enlarged. So these stomach content and esophageal junction will come up in the thoracic cavity. This is the hiatal or sliding hernia, which is acquired hernia. So here the most important feature is the gastroesophageal junction and cardiac end of stomach from normal position come up into the thoracic cavity. Not all the part of stomach, but cardiac end of stomach or gastroesophageal junction will come up in the thoracic cavity. And what are the causes? What are the causes which causes hiatal and sliding hernia? What are the defects which causes hiatal or sliding hernia? You saw the esophageal opening was present in the muscular part. When the muscles surrounding the esophageal opening in the diaphragm become weak, so the opening will be become weak. Like it will not be, there will not be sphincteric effect of diaphragm because the muscles become weak, though opening will become large in the diaphragm. So then stomach will come up into the thoracic cavity. So this is the cause of hiatal or sliding hernia, that is weakness of diaphragmatic muscles surrounding esophageal opening will cause hiatal or sliding hernia. Or when there is increased intra-abdominal pressure, when pressure in the abdomen will increase, the abdominal pressures forces the stomach and gastroesophageal junction and some part of stomach, that is cardiac, and pushes up into the thoracic cavity. That's why also intra-abdominal pressure causes ultimately hiatal or sliding hernia, which is acquired hernia. So this is all about the whole topic of diaphragm. So here we have completed the diaphragm topic whole. I hope you will like this video. And if you really loved this video, please subscribe to my channel and also press the notification bell button so you will not miss any update from my new channel videos. So this is all about the diaphragm. That's enough for today. See you in the next video. Thank you so much for watching this video.